introduction to my PhD. So I'm doing a quotidian PhD, which means I'm studying two universities at the same time, somehow. I basically have supervisors in each university. So Michel and Stephanie here, and then in Belgium, at the University of Bruxelles, I have Laurence Godard. The reason to do this was really to complement skills. Initially with Michel and Laurence, so Michel being more the agroecology side and Laurence more the sociology side. And then Stephanie joined in. It's a project working mainly with women, but not only with women, but Stephanie so brought the gender side, let's say. The initial title for the PhD was Smallholder Adaptation to Climate Change, Pathways to Social and Ecological Resilience. And really when doing the initial literature review and then when we did the first exploratory trip with Michel in Senegal, we realized that, well, climate change cannot be isolated. We can't be looking just at climate change. There's just no way it's conceived as an isolated problem over there. Social aspects are understudied and they're often misunderstood. So there's a strong emphasis on the social aspects. And even if initially you try to bring climate change as a non-social aspect, all the explanations are always very strongly social. So that was a strong component. Taking the field seriously, so that comes from Howard Becker, is really the idea that fieldwork is not a nice part of your PhD where you kind of add on something that makes it look better. It's actually a huge, very important section of your PhD, and everything that happens during your fieldwork is important. So really taking it seriously, as Becker says, was a key component. I wish I could stay there longer. Obviously, there's a lot more that could be done, and I'm doing ethnographic work, so obviously I could stay much longer, but there are some limitations also. Then there was an initial emphasis on participatory action research, which was completely confirmed when we got there. They really wanted to make something that was meaningful for them. And it was really interesting because when we asked, okay, what are you interested in? They said straight away, participatory video. Which was a coincidence because I'd just done some training here. But they were very keen. They said a film had been done about their work a few years ago. And when they watched it, they didn't like it at all. It didn't represent them at all. And for now, it's the only thing that is available about them. Their village, their work. So they said, we don't want that, we want to make our own film our own way, and can you help us with that? So we were then discussing, okay, how can we adapt all this? I'm based in Senegal, so West Africa. The Atlantic Ocean is very important. There's Mauritania in the north, Mali, Guinea-Conakry, Guinea-Bissau, and then there's the Gambia here in the middle. If we look at the satellite image, so the Sahara is over there. You can see it has a strong influence here in the north. Here, the Casamance is known for its lush vegetation. And you can easily imagine that this here was green before, just like that. But it isn't anymore because mainly of colonization. So France colonized Senegal for many decades and centuries. And this whole area now is called the basin, the peanut basin, sorry. And it was basically deforested to produce peanuts so that then France could export peanut oil to all the kitchens in France. My grandma, my mum grew up eating peanut oil fried stuff. So you can easily imagine how it was before, but now it's completely deforested. The area I'm working in is, this is called the Little Coast. And I'm right in the middle in a small village called Ndiaman. This is a protected area. This is Dakar, the capital city. And so I'm in between really rural and isolated at the capital city. It's also massively touristic. This is the biggest port. Sali is the biggest tourist port in West Africa. So a lot of tourists, a lot of French or Italian people, and all the problems that brings along. Okay. The research object for my research was a bit tricky at the beginning. I didn't really understand who am I actually going to work with. Our initial link was ASPSP, so the Senegalese Association for Peasant Seed Producers. However, when we got there with Michel, they said, it doesn't really make sense for you to work with us directly. We're too big, we're too general, let's say, so you should work with one of our organizations. And we proposed Centre AFAFA. So AFAFA is the Center for Agroecology that is created in the village where I work. However, now with my first fieldwork, I realized AFAFA is going through a lot of restructuring, let's say. stuff is changing, the land is changing, they've lost some of the land, and there are lots of changes. So even if a Fatimi seemed like this is not going to work. And I'm therefore working with Groupe Mbogaïf, which is the peasant association in the village. But the link between these two is very strong. So these provide agroecology training to these people. These are actually some of the trainers. So the link is very strong. And the person that created Centre Afafa is actually the coordinator, one of the coordinators of ASTSP. So the link, it's very blurry, but I will be focusing mainly on this group. So this is the ASPSP team. There's the creator of Afafa, Aliou, Khadija and Adalbert, two local, call them like senior researchers or something like that. And then here there are some coordinators of local projects. So Centre Afafa is coordinated by Youssou, with whom I am all the time. And he does all the translation for me and all the facilitation work with me. And then there's my invite youth, and then there are some women that are very strongly, so the president of Mbogaïf, the group I work with, Salamat Tapam, who does agroecology training around the country. Anyway, so it's a diverse group, it's a great dynamic. And this is the group Mbogaïf with whom I work more closely. So Youssou, always Youssou, and then the group and the president is Fatou Chow, who's she's taking me under her wing, but we don't speak any common language, so it's quite an interesting relationship. But we just get along together, and we spend a lot of time together, but every so often we ask for some translation, because it gets a bit funny. But the son of Adama, Mamadou, he speaks a bit of French, and we manage to communicate. Otherwise, it's Youssou. This group is a Sered group, so the ethnic group. There's 10% of the country, so it's quite small. So yeah, so to complement the previous slide about my supervisors, I should really say there's Aliou as like the overall supervisor, and then Youssou, with whom I am all the time, and Fatou Chow, with whom I hope to spend, well, most of the time in the future, unless with Youssou, so that I really spend more time in the village. So the plan was that, to work with them, and then when I got to Senegal 3 months ago, there was a change. ASPSP spoke with me, they said, we do have a participatory video project, but it's around the country. It's a bid we've just won. We're looking for a trainer. Do you want to do it? Do you want to facilitate? So it's 4 regions, and you'd be going along the 4 regions we work with and doing all the training. So I said yes, because I thought it'd be a really interesting opportunity to understand how ASPSP works, understanding other groups, and then go back to Ndiaman, understanding the difference. What's special about Ndiaman? Because everyone talks about Ndiaman in quite a special way. They say, oh wow, they know so much and everything. But really, how much compared to the others? So the project they had, ASPSP, had some conditions. It had to be participatory video. They had funding for 5 women and 2 youngsters. By youngsters, understand men. And men are not necessarily young. So when I start asking ages, they don't really know ages, but how old they are. But one of them, for example, Dawid, who we work a lot, anyways, he's 52. By young, I thought 18, 20. Mm-hmm. So, and Dawid was saying, I'm young, I deserve to be here. So basically, it's more 5 women, 2 men. Sorry?
50 is the new 30.
Yeah, it is more 50. By the way, feel free to interrupt and ask questions. So that was the standard. And for women, they had to be local, because what they found was, knowledge needs to stay in the area. And married, because in Senegal, when you marry, you move to your husband's family. And what they found in previous training, a different group did somewhere else, was that they trained only the young, because they were keen. But then they all got married, and they all left, and now there's nothing there. So there's a bit of knowledge scattered, but you need a bit of a momentum going. So they said, you need to be local, you need to be married, and you need your husband's permission. And this is not a little detail, this is essential. We did have one woman that said, yeah, of course I have my husband's permission. And then on the second day in the afternoon, she didn't turn up. We called her and said, oh, I haven't told my husband. I told him I was going for a meeting. It's taking too long. He started asking questions and realized it's a 3-day long training, so she was not allowed to come back. Which was a real shame. So So yeah, that's essential. Also because the people trained are then expected to go and film other events. So ASPSB organizes a lot of seed fairs, so these people will then go and film the seed fair, so it's kind of internal video and knowledge sharing. Equipment allocation. So they had the plan to have two smartphones per group, so the women can film with their smartphones and do all the film editing also somehow with the smartphones. We would stay with them. When I spoke with them, there were no smartphones here. They were looking for funding, so I just said, look, I brought two cameras, two tripods. I've got everything needed. Let's just get started. And later on, we'll do a meeting again when we have phones, if we have phones, and we'll retrain with phones. But at least let's get going, because, and until now, I've not seen any phones, so it's a good job we got started. But the requirement is to leave equipment there. I left equipment for Afafa, but not for the other three regions, obviously. Okay, I had my own conditions, a bit of a strong word, but I said, we really need to adapt to women. And this was a real challenge. Because usually the person that represents women is a man, and the man speaks on behalf of the women, but when we actually asked, they weren't contacting women. They're saying, oh, women want this, women want that. Yes, women are ready tomorrow. And we're like, well, really, do you know? And so there's a lot of discussion. I was going a bit far also culturally sometimes, because I was confronting men quite a bit, but doing things that I'm allowed to do, but locals would not be allowed. So it's a bit of a tricky game, but it meant that in the end the decision was to do all the training in the village, so the women didn't have to go anywhere. That's always the problem. Being allowed, getting permission from your husband, and on top of that, to go somewhere else was asking too much. So we said, we'll come to you, we'll do all the training where you are. And the time's the same. Give us your free time, and we'll adapt to that. If that means there's less time to train, less time to train, but we want you there. We don't want to pretend it's for women and then there's only men. Or like, it really needs to be a dynamic that works for everyone. Freedom to choose themes. For me, it was very important that people get used to the technical side, and so the subject was their own choice. I didn't want to say, oh, actually, I'm working on climate change. Do you want to do a video about climate change? I said, you do a video about whatever you want. And that was fine for ASPSB also. So even giving ideas, what we found was, so the local representative would say, how about a video about seeds? And then when we asked people, what video do you want to make? And they said, seeds. We realized, even giving examples about it, let's just let them do it. They decide everything. And it worked fine. They had lots of ideas. But as soon as somebody suggests, especially somebody higher up in the hierarchy, then you lose your ideas and you do what you're told. I'll leave it like that. All outcomes are shared. So these videos are not just for ASPSB, they're for everyone. Of course, if people accept to share their videos, first it's the group that decides. But as soon as they say, okay, we can share, then I wanted to make sure that the group had a copy of the videos and all the rushes. ASB had theirs, and I had them because I need them for my PhD. So really sharing outcomes. Training was open to all interested. Yes, 5 plus 2, but why not more if they're keen? So we left it open. And then the facilitator doesn't touch the equipment. This was just a requirement between facilitators, because it's so easy to grab a camera, do it yourself, and then you're surprised because others don't know how to do it. So we never touched the cameras. You had to explain everything. And he also created a really good dynamic between them, because I was just there like, oh, like this, like that. They can understand French a lot more than what they were telling me, but that was another conclusion. But so just saying here and like this and like that, and then they helped each other, and it really created a good knowledge sharing group. So here are the locations, and the colors are for different languages. So we had here the two Sere groups, the Yaman, the village where I work, and Europe. This side is the Wolof group, which is the main language spoken in Senegal. And then the Chantier was Poulat. Interestingly, in Europe, for example, one of the videos we'll watch is half in Seret, half in Wolof. So two people are speaking, but at different times, and they're actually speaking different languages, which for them is completely normal. I was really confused. And I thought translating would slow down everything. They're really used to it. They really don't mind stopping. If anything, in Senegal and probably in Africa, you do learn that time is more stretchy, let's say, than here. And yeah, so there are different dynamics in Europe. They also did a video in French, actually. So there was a lot of traveling involved, and especially to go to Gué des Chantiers is quite an adventure. To go back to numbers, so this is the Gué des Chantiers team, so in the north. There's Khadija, Yusu, and I as facilitators. There are 5 women and 2 young men. So pretty standard, it was a good solid group. This is in Yemen. You can see there are 3 men, one next to one joined in. A few more women, girls that would come after school. As soon as you're free, they'd run to join us. And then there are quite a few babies. And this is Lissar. So Lissar was a massive women's association that is solid. They do everything together. It was really surprising. Well, to me, I had to see how it was definitely a community thing. So the women are all here in the back. There are a few here in the front also. The white women are all here sat on chairs. So they were keeping an eye, giving their opinion. And they were the ones that at the end would select the 5. So there's an interesting dynamic there. Obviously, these women have their daughters in the group. So you can imagine how it goes. My daughter, my daughter-in-law, and this and that. And the children were doing anything to get into the film. So they would run in, they'd start crying, they'd go, oh, mom, I need this. And so when I said, let's take a picture together, they were all there like, oh, I'm on my film, so I deserve to be on the picture. This obviously presented its own challenges. So we ended up doing 2 groups of 20, 25 women each. So quite a challenge. And the heat. So we'll see that later. So to give you a brief overview of how 3 days worked, we only had 3 days. Women said we can't have more than 3 days. And I'll see in a second. So we would always start with welcome speeches. Everyone meets. You're greeted by the wives. You're greeted by the chief of the village. You do your speech. You explain why you're here, what you want to do. These are very important moments. You do your prayers also. Motivations and expectations, so everyone discusses what you're expecting from these 3 days. And then a work agreement, so we talk about how we're actually going to work. How many are we, where are we, and how we're going to work. And the time, so we had 4 groups, 3 of which during Ramadan. So the women said, we work between 10 a.m. and 2 p.m, that's it. 3 days, 4 hours each day. Which obviously when you've done the inside share training and they tell you, oh, 6 days full time, whatever, you're like, oh, what are we gonna do? But it was fine because when they were there, they were very keen, and that's the reality. Women don't have much free time, so we made it happen. And then consent was very important, trying to explain how it works, quite a challenge because the internet, for example, is a bit of a blurry notion. And for example, I put Gué des in red because I tried to explain, once it's on Facebook, you can't take it back in a way. They said, oh, we're not sharing anything. It just stays in the village, between us, not even in the village, let alone on the internet, no way. And then, so we discussed it, and it was funny because when we filmed the consent, so everything's filmed, the woman doing the consent, she actually wanted it everywhere. So when she filmed it, she said, oh, this will be shared within the group, in the village, and everywhere in the world. Cut. And we were there like, well, that's not the agreement. And she was like, well, you know, it's all the same. So what we agreed was at the end of the training, we'd review that. If we want to change it, we'd film it again. If not, it's okay. And by the end, they said, yeah, it's fine, we agree with that consent. But it's very cheap of her to add that little line as if nobody would understand. So sorry, I'll go by section. So this covered the camera and introductions. Putting the camera up, so we were all sat in a circle, so this is actually work now. We're all sat in a circle, there's the camera in the middle. I was asked who has never touched the camera, which is a bit of a redundant question because they all looked at each other like me. So nobody had ever touched the camera before, it was very rare, but it was great. They'd pick it, we'd explain, and very quickly we'd start the introductions game, so you film somebody opposite you, they introduce themselves, and you go around like this. It went very well, they explained each other, so very quickly the facilitator is just an extra person, and yeah, so the introductions. Straight away we project, and we do a discussion about it, and surprise was very common, so we've just filmed this, we're now seeing it on a wall in a house, like, it's so quick, it's so immediate, they were really surprised, and the discussion would flow naturally. They see straight away what the problem is, if it's noise, if it's light, if it's framing, whatever, they see it straight away, so it was very fluid. Lisa is in red because there was no protection. We realized when we got here that there was no power. So they had to find a generator, so for the evening, so that was the mission for the village chief, to find us somehow a projector with a generator for the evening. And then discovered the tripod, because a lot of times the previous exercise was very shaky. So it was a tripod, trying to set it up, and then doing two teams, and the challenge was to set it up as quickly as possible, while so the camera had to be at the same height of my eyes. And then framing exercises, so filming different things. And then the disappearing game, we only did it in demand because it worked really badly. I must have not explained it very well. They didn't get it. It was babies coming in and out. It didn't work, so we never did it again. And then if we had time, so only two groups were happy to allocate some of the time in the afternoon, so we did that. We managed to do interviews, project the interviews, and discuss the interviews. Day two, so, sorry, I forgot one thing before. When day one was finished, we would give the equipment, and people are free to film whatever they want. This was really, really important. I completely underestimated it. It was a moment where people got used to the equipment without me being there, and being able to kind of film each other in a very informal way, which was funny because I think sometimes they forgot we would watch it the day after. But it was really important. Day one, people were a bit funny, afraid of the camera. Day two, they have no fear whatsoever, especially amongst themselves. So in the evening of day one, we would project the free filming. If not in that evening, we'd project it in the morning after. Then we did the storyboard explanation. So what is it? Nobody wanted to touch a pen or a paper, so it was all oral. And then filming film one, co-editing if they had time. They were very welcome to do it with me otherwise, but it was available. And then a public projection and a discussion at the end of day one. It's not the computer, it's not. Okay, day three, so the last day, we talk again about motivations and the lessons learned. Anyways, we always did this as we projected and discussed. We did the tech presentation, so this was kind of the reality of video, participatory video. There are cameras, there are batteries, cards. Explaining all this was quite a challenge, especially for me, because I was struggling to find examples and the right words for people to understand me. But there were always, in a big group, there were always a few people that were keen and asking questions. The others would kind of fall asleep or something.
Mm-hmm. Were you explaining in French or in English?
I would always talk in French, slowly and very clearly, and really 30% of the women understood everything, but they would never tell me. They would just, mm-hmm. And then I realized they knew. And there was a translation straight away. Plus then amongst themselves, repetition is beyond belief.
So do you think you felt it was challenging also because you had learned it in English?
No, I don't think that was a problem. I think it's just a problem that a lot of the women didn't have mobile phones. The ones that did had pretty simple mobile phones. So then talking, about a micro USB card, mm-hmm. and how my colleague had a 2 giga, I had a 64 giga. So explaining that these two things are the same but yet completely different, and you're like this trying to hold it, and saying this shouldn't get too much sand, really, you need to be careful.
Yeah.
and there's noise in Lisal. We had 50 women in one room. That's 15 babies probably. So a lot of crying, turn around, give breastfeed, put back in the back, keep working. Life goes on. So this kind of little technical aspect is quite challenging. Actually, in the tech presentation in Lisal, they managed to delete everything that was in the camera. Which again reminds you that backing up is very important. Because I really turned around and was like, delete it, no problem, I've got everything on my computer, and kept going. And they don't know how they did it, we were just trying to change the settings on the camera. And so yeah, adapt to the circumstances. Second day, storyboard, filming, co-editing if possible, and then public projection with thank you speeches. So we had, again, sharing all the outcomes. On the last day, we showed everything that had been done in that village, plus what had been done in the other villages, if I had anything available from the previous training. Okay, challenges. Formal education. Lots of times people said, I can't participate, I've not been to school. And we insisted, it doesn't matter. You don't need to speak French, you don't need to go to school. And indeed, they saw straight away, it didn't matter at all. Tech literacy, again, it didn't matter. People really just found out on the day, that's it, get on with it. Climate and culture. Climate is a challenge, it's very hot. Very sunny, so you'll see in a few films the light is just so strong you just get like big white patches. It's the sky. And then culture, well, it was Ramadan, it was very tiring, it's very hot, so we were adapting to that. Women have very different schedule at home during Ramadan, so that's why they were free only at 10, and then in the afternoon they're already starting to prepare dinner and everything, so we had to be very careful with that. And if there are men, the 2 o'clock prayer is very important, so they would just leave. But that was fine, it's just the way it is. Oh, I was working so well again. Okay, access to electricity. For them, for participants, it wasn't a challenge. We didn't want them to worry about it, but for us, it was a constant concern. How can we charge batteries? I took tons of batteries, and I'm very happy I did because we needed them. So the only thing was really night projection, because for that I didn't have enough battery power. But it was manageable. Group dynamics were a funny one. You do feel a lot of pressure, there's a lot of expectation. And a few times I had to speak again with reference, trying to manage pressure within the village, us as externals. I sometimes just played yes, the game of I'm not from here, I don't know about this. And I know my colleagues did a lot of, let's say, managing between participants and then the village. So a lot of diplomacy behind all this. Peer pressure is quite strong, especially for participants. So for example, one of the participants, Amina Tao, was getting a lot of pressure because she'd not been to school. And people were implying she would not do well. This is something I only understood after a day or two. And so she ended up being the best student of that group because she just worked so hard. But I think peer pressure was very strong, even within dynamics, within the same group, you could have 2 co-wives, so with the same husband. So you obviously want to be the one that gets home and says, well, I did a better film than her, so really you should spend more time with me than your other wife. Mm-hmm. So the dynamics are that quite tricky. Oral culture, it's not a problem, but for me it was a challenge because I just realized I write everything. I memorize by writing. People had names I'd never heard before, and even just the idea of how will I remember your name? How do you write it? Oh, no, you don't write it. So I try and spell it somehow. So the fact that nothing is written for me is a real challenge. For them, no problem whatsoever. They know what they're going to film, how, which order, no problem. But yeah, for me it was a bit tricky. And also I wanted sometimes some paper that I can photograph and show this is the order they want or whatever. Immediacy from participants and for myself was very important. I wanted to be able to show it as quickly as possible. Here it is. So a film is made within the day. It's a 5-minute film. It's filmed in the right order and that's it. Barely any editing. Here you go. So this was very related to the specific case I was in. Language, again, was a problem for me. I was the one that didn't speak the language, but that's the way things should be. we didn't want everyone to speak French because then participants would be with a different bunch. So they were always speaking their own language, and all the films are in their own language. There's no discussion about that. And life in general, because the things happen. So I was talking before about babies. You'll hear birds, they're very loud. People come in, come out. The mosque suddenly starts calling during our footage. But that's life, and it didn't really bother us. You wouldn't even notice, and even animals going in and out of the frame, that's fine. I think other people, when they watch it, they'll be like, you didn't control the situation very well, but I didn't even try. I think there's no point with it. So the conditions, this is, just go back, so this is one of the huts in Diaman, where we had to work sometimes, and it's very, very hot. And then we had to close the window and the door to do the projection during the day. It was very hot. So people were clearly showing they were keen because they were staying in this oven for quite a while. In Lisa, we were working under the trees, which was a challenge also sometimes. I mean, cameras and everything, I couldn't insist more about being careful. Okay, I'd like to show you two films. The first one is from Diaman, it's the very first film from the very first group that was trained, and it's called Women Who Master the Sereti Tradition. Let's hope it works.
Yeah. that was filmed in just a day then, Carla, or over 2 days?
That was probably an hour.
Oh, wow.
Oh.
Filming.
Mm.
Yeah, an hour filming. Probably an hour preparing, and then an hour filming. And all in the same courtyard.
Mm.
Literally just... It was a great way to get a lot of women in one film.
Mm.
Really organized. They said, okay, we'll go 2x2, and it's a lot of improvisation. The one that did before the praying at the end said, I don't want to be in it. And then when she saw all of it, she said, film me now. And she did her talk, like, we represent the population of the Yaman, and then the praise at the end. So yeah, very quick and very... And then I just wanted to share this one also, so it's a shorter one from a different group.
Phones, and obviously there are no laptops. why make videos? I mean, it's not really for their own benefit. I mean, in terms of spreading knowledge.
Yeah.
No?
It's
or
a good question. They really want to do it, and they know somebody will have the video on their laptop, and they want to show it as soon as possible to other people. If it, I think the key thing will be to put it, them on Facebook, because they love Facebook. And you do get, so when you charge your phone, you get a few hours on Facebook only, things like that. So sharing videos is really important. People I live with are constantly watching videos on Facebook. So it's there's that weird thing of you do struggle to have access to all this technology, but then when it's there, they love watching it. And if your eldest son has a phone, then every so often you ask for the phone and you watch your videos, even on a rubber screen, right? So, and there's that thing of knowing it's for the future. So the ladies in the village I work with, they're all quite old. They all have sons that are like children that are like 20, 30, sometimes even older. And they say we want to pass on the knowledge and we think we'll attract the youth by using videos. So it's also a conscious effort to relate to a different generation, which is definitely work because the girls, it's mainly girls going to school and they're saying like, oh, as soon as I finish classes, I'll come and join you. So there's that motivation.
Yeah, I noticed that the first couple of ladies had a paper.
Yeah.
One of them. It looked like kind of reassurance of what they were going to say, but actually they don't. You said they don't write things down anymore.
So it was, I gave boys a piece of paper with six squares and I said, shall we do six sequences and fill them in with whatever you want to say? Having in mind, first one's introduction, last one's conclusion. And that one with the chickens, they literally drew a chicken.
Mm.
And so they it was for reassurance. And it was kind of like, so one woman, for example, in a different group, I noticed she always kept a book with her, which I thought was more of a status thing. You know, I've got a book with me. So there's also something about the image. Who keeps the camera bag? There's also that, you know. And I was saying the camera bag should always be with the person that has the camera, because if you're going to leave it, if you're going to stop using it, you can put it in. But then it was kind of, why would you share, why would you keep all the pleasure just for yourself? You know, share the pleasure. Somebody has the bag, you have the camera. So it's like, well, good, but make sure you stick together then. But yeah, for me it was a real challenge, this thing of storyboard and how to follow the order. And then we grow up in such a, we grew up in discipline. And my parents were not that obsessed with discipline, but you, order is something I definitely have built in me, and chronology. Whilst they were saying, well, if we change sequence 2 and 3, it's not a big deal. And I'm like, well, the chicks are born after the chicken lays the eggs. And they're like, yeah, we can be the previous chicks. I'm like, oh, fair enough. But so, there's always an answer.
What about with the subtitling? Was there a collective decision to have subtitles in English?
No, that was my imperative for the PhD.
Oh, right, that was.
Yeah. So, I felt French subtitles were the first step. Well, basically, I didn't understand any of the videos. You saw the praying. There's actually a section where she prays for the facilitators. I didn't know, I was there like this. And then they came to see me and they're like, she's just thank you for your work. And I was like, oh, thank you. So I actually realized what the films were about once I got home and sat down with my colleague with Yusu and we translated. I was like, okay, it's about this. And next time I went to the village and I was like, oh, it's really cool what you said about chickens and this and that. There's a lot more that could be analyzed. The chickens that I translated as broiler chickens, and I think I need to review that, are actually called tubab chickens, so colonizer chickens or white people's chickens.
Mm-hmm.
And they're basically the hybrid version. So me saying broiler is not really a very faithful translation, but they're basically saying our chickens are better than the colonizer ones. And they explain why ours just grow naturally, the other ones in medication, whatever. So translations were a really long process and trying to find subtleties, but at the same time they speak a lot and they use images that we don't have here. And so you can't really translate literally, but you're always missing something. Translating is betrayal, isn't it? Traduire, c'est trahir.
How do these videos relate to your sort of PhD process?
Yeah,
how, either in terms of the process or the output, are they shaping research questions,
yeah,
or how?
Can I, I'll answer that in a second, just in the next slide, but it's a very good question. So yeah, all these videos now are on YouTube, well, most of them I'm working on the translations, but Lisa did 4 videos, and the last group, Guy Deschantier, did 2 videos, which I'm not ready yet, because I've not, I've struggled with the translation from Poulard, because Yusuf couldn't do it, but they will come soon enough, I hope. So, reflections. Pride and responsibility. The, especially on the first day, but really when talking to people about, okay, how did you go? What did you find this first day? Pride is by far the biggest emotion. People were very, very proud. And not just for themselves. They're saying, you know, I'm representing my family, I'm representing my village. This is a, an amazing occasion. So thank you for selecting me within the 5, and they were talking to the wider group. But they're saying, they often said, especially women, they said, I never thought I would have the opportunity to do this. Not only I have it, I'm actually, well, grabbing the chance, and I'm managing to do it. I can do this video. This is actually quite simple. I can do it. So there's a big surprise and confidence. They're saying, well, I feel better about myself. I feel like I can now represent my community elsewhere. So pride was a big deal. Yes, I can. And responsibility. So they're saying, at the same time, I'll work very hard to deserve this place. In Lisade, for example, 50 women, only 5 selected. They're saying, I'll work hard to be one of the 5. And really, you can see that. You can see they were trying their best and trying to find ways to excel. They were really amazing. Emotion was another word that came a lot. And interestingly enough, it came a lot from men's voices. So they were saying, I feel emotional when I film. Bai Diouf was the coordinator of a big farmer organization, and he's probably, I don't know, 60. He was saying, I feel too emotional, I can't stop filming, this is overwhelming. I don't know how to deal with this. It's a lot, and they were struggling to find words to express themselves. And again, pride. I want people to see me with the camera. And they admitted that they went past crowds like this, like a camera. And sometimes we had 2 people filming the same thing. We went to an event, and the 2 would be there, and you could see us kind of show up. Like, I'm doing the Zoom now, you are not doing the Zoom. So there's a lot of that also, which was very interesting. Keeping the camera was a big deal. I was saying, share the equipment. Sometimes I didn't want, but they said, I can't stop. It's too good to film. So that was an interesting comment. Answers are within. I'm very hands-off for training, and I think that with video, participatory video, you really can. People see straight away what's wrong, like I mentioned before, and the discussion is more within them. I could help sometimes with more technical aspects. It was like, how can we deal with this or that? But even then, they really understand straight away. It's very straightforward, I find. Role reversal in video. So this was this came as a comment from the wise. When I say the wise, it's the elderly people that were watching the videos. And they were very confused. They said, basically, the young in these films are saying what we always say, and we thought they were listening. So now, not only they're saying it, but they're saying it on video so that they can share elsewhere. So they were really proud of saying, there is some hope after all, they do know what's going on. And all the videos is also quite interesting. They didn't want to show just the organic side, for example. They said, no, let's have a conventional farmer, an organic farmer, and they talk. And then we see the pros and cons, as you saw with the chickens. The one that has the broiler chickens, the new varieties, yes, requires medication, but she also admits, well, I do make profit, and then I can buy furniture for my children and whatever. So it's not all bad and all good. They always try to present the 2 sides, which I thought was great. But the elderly thought it was quite surprising to hear it from the children, their own children. Yeah, finding creative solutions was really interesting. So sometimes we were limited in space. They're not allowed to go very far for different reasons. But so sometimes we were just in one house. And in one case, for example, we were in a house that was unfinished, in a room that was unfinished. And I was saying, if we film everything in a grey room with cement and bricks, it's pretty ugly. And so straight away, they went to get fabric, or they take their own scarves, they put them on the floor to decorate the walls, bring some branches, whatever, and so each scene looks very different, and they understood that very clearly. So they're very creative. Last day is the hardest, not only because you're tired, but also because there was a sense of, now I know what it is, so I can do it by myself. And they kind of realized that the second day we gave a lot of advice, saying, like, you know, try to do a screenplay, try to film it in the right order. But on the third day, when they made their second film, they didn't want to prepare, they just wanted to improvise. But then realized that if you improvise too much, the film, when one of the films is 20 minutes long, and it's mainly, but it's improvised, it's quite a long process, let's say. So they learned the hard way that preparing is actually really important also. So videos of agriculture and social events. So that's kind of going back to your question. I really wanted them to choose whatever theme they find relevant. And in the end, it's pretty much 50% is about farming and 50% about social events, mainly weddings and christenings. And I thought, I will only be able to use 50% of the material because I'm not studying Sered wedding practices. But actually, the Sered video, which I've not shown, but it's available, they prepare the bride for the wedding, so before taking her to the husband's house. And so she's sad, she's got a scarf on her head, and they do a whole prayer pouring millet on top of her head. Millet seeds, and they explain, may you be as productive as this millet. This is our family's peasant seed. May you have as many children as this millet has had grains. And then there's a whole symbolic of the bride takes her family's seeds to her husband's family, and she's responsible for growing that seed and mixing it with the family's the husband's family seed, and then improving the seeds of the husband's family, which is very symbolic, obviously, but it's very meaningful. And then I realized, actually, agriculture is everywhere. Even in the christening, they talk a lot about farming, and the whole idea that so women bear the children, and they also keep the seed. It's all related, and you can't separate them. And if a woman just had a baby that we're now christening, she must grow good crops also, because she just had a beautiful baby. So, you know, it's all related. So, yeah, I am actually probably going to analyze all of it. The thing is, not all the videos are about Indian man. Some areas are completely different when you look at geoclimatic conditions. But I'm going to try to find a way to use it. Myself. So it's really funny because yes, there is a motivation to show you about the camera, but there's also a motivation to show that you're not that bothered because you already know about this. And especially men, they were like, oh, I'm not listening. Of course I know how to change the memory card on a camera, and then they're going to check it because they didn't know. And they would make mistakes by themselves and then not want to ask anybody else for the correction. So it's funny, and even amongst women, I found that. So a woman does a lot of agroecology training around the country. She's really well known for her knowledge and everything. And she came a bit like, I'm coming to support the young. But actually, she performed really poorly because she wasn't putting any effort. Whilst the ones that felt they were being criticized by their peer group performed really well because they wanted to show, yeah, I am learning, and they did really well. So it's funny to see that kind of role reverse in a way. Mobile phones, I'll just mention very quickly, but they're everywhere. And then they're very present. Being interrupted by a call is no problem, so you might be in the middle of a conversation, suddenly people will just turn around and talk, or even just keep looking at you and talk, and you're talking to them, and they're like, yeah. So it's not, it's quite disturbing, but I tried to ignore it as my approach. Language is really interesting. As I told you, I realized people could understand a lot more than they were telling me. Women didn't want to speak French sometimes in front of men because it would be showing power. So if there's a man, they wouldn't say anything. If there's no men, then they talk to me. So there's a lot of dynamic like that with language, with French. But also I felt they create a really healthy barrier in a way because they kind of tested me at the beginning, like, do you understand Serer? Do you understand Wolof or Pular? And I was just completely lost. And suddenly they felt the freedom of doing whatever they wanted. And they really used that. And they would ask me about technical things, but they would do whatever they wanted. Whilst we the other facilitators, they would jump in, comment, and we're kind of like, oh, I don't want to do this. I don't want your opinion. But with me, they knew there was no chance. I didn't understand the thing, and I really felt it gave them freedom, and really limited my input into the technical side. So the initial frustration was kind of replaced by the happiness to see that they were using that freedom and really enjoying it. The notion of frame I found was very interesting because it doesn't really mean anything. So people were seeing a film as just part of a continuum. So people come in and out of the frame. I was trying to explain that whatever is out doesn't matter. And they were like, why not? Or, you know, it's a selection. What do you want in, what do you want out? If you're going to speak, try to be on screen. But no, and then also with editing, I was saying, shall we remove the beginning where you say, come on, start? And they're like, why? That's part of the film. Or like here with the prayer, that prayer was not planned. They just said, let's pray now because it's the end of the day and we've had a really happy day. So I made the film and then I mentioned, okay, how about the prayer? And they're like, well, that needs to go in. There's another film where they finished everything and then they start singing to celebrate and then they start singing about me. And I actually joined them and we're all singing and dancing. And when we went to edit, I deleted it. And they're like, no, that's obviously part of the film. And I was trying to understand, no, that's clearly out of the story. But they're saying, no, this is part of the process. We need you to be in. So the film ends with us dancing and having a laugh. So it's quite interesting to see how it's not just a story. There's everything before, after, and it's all part of it. They didn't mind at all. Okay, what next? So, heading back in September for 3 months, and now we'll only stay in Yemen. There'll be a few exchanges, but it's mainly in Yemen. And now we'll work more, so trying to understand space and time structure, so understanding how Yemen is built, let's say, with focus group discussions with peasants, field visits, and we'll do a lot of mapping together. So a lot of stories. I really felt that going elsewhere and then coming back was seen as a massive privilege for Yemen. They were really surprised when I came back. I said, oh, but you've been in all those places and now you come back to our tiny village. And I said, yeah, but you're the team I'm working with. I said, well, okay, well, you're here, so it's brave, you need to make the most of it. Oh, we've got the equipment, it's ours. Oh, right. So it really helped to build trust and to help, hopefully, with the future. Even the elderly were very keen, and I really felt they want to be filmed. The very, very old, very old man is trying to speak to me in French, and this kind of old French, and oh, bring your camera next time. And, you know, it's quite interesting to see that. So, a lot of stories. And then paths and hopes. So, interviews and focus groups with the young. A lot of the younger members have actually left the village to work in cities and struggled so much that after 2 or 3 years came back to the village and they are now hoping to find a living in the village. So there's a lot to do with them. And all of this will be done with participatory video, really working with the same team and filming all of this. And auto-ethnography. And yeah, acknowledgement. So here at Core, everyone, and my supervisors, Michelle and Stephanie. You all be my supervisor, Laurence, and then the team in Afafa and ISPSP, the team in Mogaif, and then my husband, family, friends, colleagues for their support. And you for being here. Thank you.